My name is Arturo Evangelista. This presentation is focused on intramural hematoma and penetrating ulcer in descending aorta, differences and similarities. Acute aortic syndrome is defined as an acute process in the aortic wall caused by disruption in the medial layer with the risk of aortic rupture and other complications. Acute aortic syndrome includes aortic dissection, intramural hematoma, and penetrating aortic ulcer. Intramural hematoma accounts for 7 to 20% of acute aortic syndromes, depending on the series, being more prevalent in Asian series. The prevalence of penetrating aortic ulcer is around 5%. The most accepted hypothesis is that intramural hematoma originates from rupture of the vasa vasorum in an atherosclerotic process. Another hypothesis is a mechanism similar to classical aortic dissection, but with a small entry tear, difficult to detect on imaging studies. Other authors have proposed intimal fracture of an atherosclerotic plaque as a primary event. Penetrating aortic ulcer is defined as ulceration of an atherosclerotic plaque penetrating through the internal elastic lamina into the media. Penetrating aortic ulcer may generate a medial hematoma and also carry the risk of the aortic rupture. Intramural hematoma and penetrating aortic ulcer are more frequent than aortic dissection in the elderly, with cardiovascular risk factors, and are more often located in the descending aorta. Intramural hematoma diagnosis can be established in most cases by thickening of the aorta wall more than 5 mm, usually with crescentic or circular morphology. Intramural hematoma is diagnosed on CT by a high attenuation area which fails to enhance after contrast medium administration. See figure A. In figure B, we can see the crescentic aortic wall thickening by MRI. The signal intensity of the thickening aorta is secondary to metahemoglobin formation on T1 images after hyperacute intramural hematoma. In figure C, transesophageal echocardiography shows thickening of the aortic wall, although it offers no signals to identify acute versus chronic hematoma. In this IRAT study, we showed that the first imaging study was normal in 12% of cases, and the second identified intramural hematoma. In addition, intramural hematoma diagnosed in the first study had evolved to classical dissection on the second study in 15% of cases. So the presentation of intramural hematoma may be progressive and its evolution dynamic. Therefore, the correct diagnosis of intramural hematoma requires more than one imaging test, difference with classical dissection. In this IRAT study, we showed that the first imaging study, the mortality of type B intramural hematoma in acute phase was 10% and is lower than the mortality in classical dissection. Periaortic hematoma is more common in intramural hematomas than in aortic dissection, and as you can see here, implies a worse prognosis, but not necessarily aortic rupture. So intramural hematoma with peri-aortic hematoma presented a mortality around 40%. And without peri-aortic hematoma, the mortality was 10%. But in some cases, as in this case, peri-aortic hematoma presented a benign evolution. And this patient, after 2 months of follow-up, presented a complete regression of the intramural hematoma and periaortic hematoma under medical treatment. So, although it's a risk factor, not all cases evolve with mortality. Two types of intimal disruption have been observed during the course of intramural hematoma. The tiny intimal disruption and the focal intimal disruptions. In this case, in this slide, you can see the tiny intimal disruption that is defined as an orifice diameter less than 3 millimeters. And these images evolve with a stable size and without significant complications. And in most cases are associated with intercostal or lumbar artery ostia. Transesophageal echocardiography with color Doppler is superior to any other technique for assessing the intima and demonstrating small communications usually associated with intercostal or lumbar artery ostia. By CT with contrast enhancement in B and C figures, it is possible to demonstrate these small communications through an intimal microtear. Focal intimal disruption is defined as a focal contrast material filled pouch projecting outside the opacified aortic lumen with an orifice diameter over 3 millimeters. In this paper we published last year, we observed that focal intimal disruption in acute phase carry a high risk of aortic rupture. In that study, we conclude that this intimal disruption in acute phase, not in chronic phase, should be treated by TAVR or surgery. So it's important to remark that this focal intimal disruption, more than 3 millimeters of size, evolve with a risk of mortality in acute phase, but the pathophysiology is different after the acute phase, and in chronic phase, the evolution is more benign. Therefore, we recommend surgery or TAVR for patients with complicated intramural hematoma. And our opinion, the best predictors are the persistence of pain or refractory high blood pressure, significant periaortic hematoma, intimal tear in acute phase, a focal intimal disruption with a size over 3 millimeters, maximum aortic diameter over 50 millimeters, or intramural hematoma thickness over 10 millimeters. This is the algorithm that we propose that in patients with complications, or predictors of complications, as I said before, we indicate endovascular treatment or surgical treatment when the endovascular is contraindicated in acute phase. In patients without these predictors, we manage the patient medically, and we follow the patient after discharge every 3 months, the first year, every 6 months in the second and third year, and annually thereafter. If we identify a sacular or fusiform aneurysm with maximum aortic diameter over 55 millimeters, or the mean growth rate of aortic diameter per year over 5 millimeters, or signs of rupture or enlargement of this focalized intimal disruption with a dip more than 3 millimeters per year, we indicate also endovascular treatment or surgical treatment. Without these signs, these findings, we manage the patient medically, trying to reduce the cardiovascular risk factors, control the blood pressure, and we follow the patient with the imaging technique. This is a case that a patient with type B intramural hematoma. In A, we can see the image of the intramural hematoma in proximal descending thoracic aorta, that the aorta evolved with a significant dilation at 2 weeks. You can see in figure B, the arrow show the dilation of this part of the aorta. So we indicated TEVR procedure. And after 3 months of treatment, no complications were observed in figure D. However, endovascular treatment in acute phase of intramural hematoma carries the risk of generating secondary endoleaks, a new intimal rupture. When the ends of the device are placed on non-normal aorta wall, the risk is high. Mechanical stress and the pulsatile force acting on the stent ends on the aorta wall, weakened by the intramural hematoma, may favor these new lesions, as you can see here in D and E, the extremes of the stent that presented solve the problem of this ulcer-like image, this localized dissection that is shown in A and correctly resolved in B after the TEVR implantation, but we have a new lesions at the extremes, at the end of the stents implanted in acute phase. So it's very important to try to implant the stent with extremes located in healthy aorta. After acute phase, intramural hematoma evolution is also very dynamic. In our series, we found that 34% of patients presented in less than 6 months a complete reabsorption of the intramural hematoma without any complication. In 12%, the patients evolve to classical dissection. In 24%, the patients presented these images of a pseudoaneurysm that are the images produced by the localized dissection. And some radiologists say that ulcer-like projections, 24% of cases. In 8% of cases, the patients presented a saccular aneurysm, and in 22% of cases, the patients evolved to fusiform aneurysms. So that is important to remark that we have around 35% of patients that there are not any complication, and the resolution of the intramural hematoma is complete without dilation. And in the other cases, the most frequent evolution is aneurysms or pseudoaneurysms of the aorta. You can see here the evolution of the intramural hematoma that in this case evolved with a complete regression after 4 months. This was observed by a transesophageal echocardiography at the same level of the intramural hematoma in descending thoracic aorta. And similarly, you can see in a CT control that we have a complete reabsorption of the intramural hematoma without aorta dilation that was present in 34%. In more than 20% of cases, we observe that the intramural hematoma evolved with enlargement of the aorta and with a fusiform aneurysm formation. And around 25% of cases, we can see that the localized dissection, this focal intimal disruption that presented these ulcer-like images at different levels of the aorta, and in some cases, these images in acute phase has a high risk of complications. In subacute or chronic phase, in some cases persist stable, in other cases evolve with a progressive. In this case, you can see this patient that with this ulcer-like image secondary to the localized intimal disruption, that after 6 years of evolution, the patient presented the same, exactly the same size of this localized dissection. So now we are moving to the penetrating aortic ulcer. There are several types of aortic ulcers which have different pathophysiology, evolution, and management. The most simple is the ulcerated atherosclerotic plaques, which are superficial and respect the media layer. The evolution is very stable and the risk of complications is very low. These patients may need to do control by imaging techniques, reduce their cardiovascular risk factors, and maybe prescribe statins. But there are not really an acute process of the media, only localized in the intima layer. Penetrating aortic ulcers are essentially penetrating atherosclerotic ulcer. An atherosclerotic plaque in a calcified atherosclerotic aorta. As you can see in the figure A, the ulcer penetrates the media. And these are, we have two examples here, the figure A and the figure C. But there are other images that we have, other ulcers that we have to make the differential diagnosis. As the figure B, that in this case is a localized dissection after 6 months of intramural hematoma. So imaging is important, try to differentiate these A and C to B. A and C presented the atherosclerosis calcification, and B is the evolution of the intramural hematoma that presented a localized dissection and a similar ulcer-like image, but is a different pathophysiology and different evolution, as I will see. Transesophageal echocardiography is useful in the differential diagnosis of aortic ulcer etiology. In A, we can see the ulcerated plaque in descending thoracic aorta intima without involvement of the medial layer of the aortic wall. In B, we have an atherosclerotic ulcerated lesion penetrating through the aortic intima into the aortic wall that also generated penetrating atherosclerotic ulcer. In this case, it has a worse prognosis than only an intimal atherosclerotic ulcer. And in C, we can see that is an intramural hematoma that presented this type of focal intimal disruption. If you administrate contrast, maybe all the three images presented an ulcer of the aorta, but the pathophysiology, the progression, and the risk is completely different. In A, it's benign. In B, if this lesion is acute, presented a high risk of complications, and in C, also out of the acute phase, is benign. This is another case that we can see that the usefulness of transesophageal echocardiography in the diagnosis of penetrating aortic ulcer located in the aortic arch. In A is you can see that the arrow show the presence of this ulcer. In B is the same ulcer using angio CT. In C using MRI, and in D using transesophageal echocardiography. In this case, only transesophageal echocardiography identified the localized dissection, that is a focal intimal disruption, from the natural evolution of the intramural hematoma. So finally, this case is this ulcer is secondary to the rupture, intimal rupture, localized in the aortic arch of in the evolution of the intramural hematoma, and is not really a penetrating atherosclerotic ulcer. In this case, we have a penetrating aortic ulcer surrounded by intramural hematoma. The patient was treated medically. Despite the absence of symptoms, MRI performed at 1 year showed a hyperintensity signal and of bleeding of the aortic wall in B. And after 5 years of follow-up, a saccular aneurysm was observed with the diameter increasing from the 38 millimeters at the beginning to 105 millimeters. So this is a typical case that the penetrating aortic ulcer does not present a rupture in the acute phase, but evolves with asymptomatic bleeding and evolve finally to a saccular aneurysm without any symptom. In this study, published by the group of Eleftheridis, survival was better in patients with penetrating aortic ulcer treated surgically in blue than initially treated medically. So, also, this study suggests that patients with a penetrating aortic ulcer with an acute phase, maybe is have better prognosis if we treat these patients surgically than medically. This is a series that there are not many series that compare the penetrating aortic ulcer and localized dissection with these ulcer-like images. And the differential diagnosis of both entities are very important as the evolution is completely different and requires different management. In this meta-analysis that included 45 patients, we can see that 87% of cases presented a localized intramural hematoma around the penetrating aortic ulcer, and evolved with a pseudoaneurysm formation in 26% of them, and 8% of patients presented aortic rupture. So the evolution is very aggressive. By contrast, in the KIN study, we can see in 49 patients with localized dissection that also show this type of ulcer-like images, the evolution is very stable because only 63% of patients were stable and only 37% of patients presented the lesion of aneurysm and no aortic rupture. So there are two entities with a very similar images that we have to differentiate because the risk is completely different and we have to treat more aggressively the penetrating aortic ulcer than the localized dissection secondary to the ulcer-like images from the evolution of the intramural hematoma. So our algorithm in patients with penetrating aortic ulcer is in acute phase, is we have a complicated course that implies some of these factors, signs of aortic rupture, persistence of symptoms despite medical treatment, increase of significant pleural effusion, The presence of intramural hematoma, more if this intramural hematoma is large. And maximum aortic diameter over 55 millimeters at the level of the lesion. Or rapid aortic growth diameter during hospitality. In these cases, we indicate endovascular treatment. If it is not possible, we indicate surgery. In patients without these factors, mainly when we identify this aortic ulcer incidentally without the symptoms, we manage the patient, and during the first year we perform a CT or MRI every 3 months. If it is stable, two times at the second and third year, and after and thereafter annually. If we observe that the diameter increase more than 5 millimeters per year, or the maximum diameter of the aorta is over 55 millimeters, or new evidence of intramural hemorrhage, as the case that I presented before, or indirect signs of aortic rupture, we indicate endovascular treatment or surgical treatment. So the conclusions are that intramural hematoma and penetrating aortic ulcer have significant differences in pathophysiology, evolution, and management. Clinical presentation may be identical to that of classical dissection. However, most penetrating aortic ulcers are diagnosed incidentally outside the acute phase. Persistent pain despite medical treatment, hemodynamic instability, maximum aortic diameter over 55 millimeters, significant periaortic hemorrhage, and focal intimal disruption in acute phase of intramural hematoma are mortality predictors. Symptomatic penetrating aortic ulcer has a high risk of complications. In all these cases, TEVR or open surgery should be considered. In non-complicated intramural hematoma or penetrating aortic ulcer without significant aortic enlargement, a strict control of cardiovascular risk factors appears to be a safe strategy. However, frequent follow-up by imaging evaluation techniques is required, and a low threshold for intervention should be maintained if symptoms recur or if the aorta enlarges significantly. Thank you.